So it's great pleasure I introduce our first speaker of the day, Casey Schaufler. Casey is one of our international speakers from San Francisco, and he's going to be talking about jargon when jargon becomes gibberish, something I do have a big problem with at times, so I'm very much looking forward to his talk today. Please welcome Casey Schaufler.
"'Twas brillig, and the slithy toes did gyre and gimble in the wabe. All mimsy were the borogroves, and the mome raths outgrabe. You EFI bootloaders execute a shim binary to address BIOS key management issues. Take your pick. I'm Casey Schaufler. I have a couple of things about myself that will become important as we go down the discussion here. I have a North Cascades rural accent with Manhattan undertones and a California Silicon Valley vocabulary. I have Northern and Western European ancestry. I was born male in the United States in the 1950s. This will identify some things that will come up as may come up as biases. Everybody has them. I'm just working to identify some of mine up front. For those of you who are in the cheap seats, I'm the one on the right. So jargon, what is jargon? Jargon is the language that is used in a particular group or activity. It may vary significantly from the way language is used otherwise, or it may be just minor difference. Or it might just be a set of habits that people use when they're talking. Gibberish is meaningless or unintelligible language, but usually it's implied that it sounds like it could be reasonable. For example, do helicopters eat their young? That's gibberish. It doesn't mean, it's good English words, they're used properly in a proper syntax, but it doesn't make any sense. Now, why do we create jargon? Well, jargon's a very useful thing. We create jargon for a number of reasons. We want to communicate with people, we want to communicate quickly and effectively, and we don't want to spend a lot of time explaining things all the time. So sometimes we don't have a word for this, for something. There is no word for the subatomic particles, or at least there wasn't until they decided to make some up. They decided to call the whole thing quarks, and because they had six of them and they were relatively arbitrary, they called them up, down, top, bottom, charm, and strange. It doesn't actually correlate to anything to use those words. There's nothing strange about a strange quark. There's nothing charming about a charm quark. They just threw arbitrary words on them so that they could identify them. All right. So sometimes it's too. We have a term, we have something we want to refer to regularly, and it's just too hard to refer to it by its true name every time. Lysergic acid dithalamide. Okay. How many times would you want to say that in a day? Not very often. So you call it LSD, or you call it acid, depending on which group you're in. Okay, if you're a pharmacist, you'll say one. If you're a frequent consumer, you're likely to call it the other. Another reason why we use jargon is sometimes we really do want to keep what we're saying in the group. And we're in we may be in a context where there are a lot of other people around who we don't really want to hear what we're talking about. My local grocery store, every so often, the speaker will come on and they will say, "Produce Department 1001. I still don't know what a 1001 is. They never call 1002, but the people who are in the grocery store know what their role is on a code 1001. That's fine, okay? Another reason why you might introduce something like this is because you don't really want other people to judge you on what you're talking about. So incident, OK? Okay. If you're running a nuclear reactor, that means something very different than if you're the parent of a six-month-old child. You'll use the term, your spouse will probably know, if you have a six-month-old child, what you mean when you say incident. And we'll probably take the child and whisk it out of the room, especially if it's being quiet. Whereas in the nuclear reactor, they'll say incident because somebody on a tour group might overhear it, and you don't want them to know that in fact the fuel rods have broken and you're about to have a meltdown. So how do we create jargon? I mean, jargon just doesn't spontaneously happen. We create jargon by using language in a particular way. So Humpty Dumpty has the assertion that a word means what I mean it to mean and nothing else. You don't want language to control you after all. It's much better that you're actually in charge of it. So we create jargon in a lot of cases just by using it, but sometimes it's more intentional. One of the things we do is we abbreviate. When we abbreviate, we take something that's big and long and shorten it down into something smaller. For example, if I say, I approve of this change and have sufficient authority for that approval to matter, it takes a while to say that. Why should I do that when I can just say plus two? We may drop letters out of a word. We may combine several words into one short one, nincompoop, for example. And hopefully it's not ambiguous in the context. Hopefully when you've abbreviated something, the people who you're talking to know what it is. It's not going to be one of a bunch of things. Now, we have a very special kind of abbreviation, and we're very fond of this one in the technology industry. It turns out a lot of industries, it's the acronym. Acronyms are great. You can say SNAFU or Tanstoffel. Anybody know what Tanstoffel means?
No such thing as
prey line. Okay. Yeah, old science fiction fans. NATO, LOL, we keep introducing these because they're easy to say. It makes things go quickly and all kinds of good things. Okay. So SCSI is an acronym. The original people who came up with these small computer system interface actually chose that name so that it would have an acronym that was pronounceable, and they said it was going to be pronounced sexy. Oops. A lot of people didn't like the interface, and so they countered with, nah, it makes more sense to call it SCSI, which has kind of this image of something growing on it. But it stuck. Yeah, people said SCSI, and there's probably still a few SCSI buses out there, not very many. But it's a case where the jargon picked up the acronym, ran with it. Everybody was happy with it. One of the fun things about acronyms, though, is that TLA is not a three-letter acronym. How many people think TLA was a three-letter acronym? Okay, it's not. It's merely a collection of letters. We don't say TLA or TLA. We say TLA. All right, so it's not an acronym. It's simply an abbreviation. And it stands for the Thailand Lacrosse Association. We also use code names. When we really want to obfuscate something, we don't want people to know what it is we're really talking about, we'll use a code name. Hardware vendors have code names for their processors or their memory chips or their circuit boards, or the next car that's coming out. Probably the best example there is of this is tank. Okay, everybody knows what a tank is. Everybody has seen these before. But in the 19-teens, when they were developing these things, they wanted a name that was as, word check, that would lead people to think that they were working on something that was very, very harmless. And that all this metal work was going into the most harmless thing that they could think of. And the most harmless thing they could think of that was made out of metal was a tank, of like a water tank. So that was the code name for this vehicle that they were building. Okay. Once they actually went out into the field, people said, what do we call this thing? They gave it a big, long, you know, official name, and everybody said, no, the engineer who came out and fixed it called it a tank. We're going to call it that. It's a whole lot easier to shout out in the battlefield, too. It's like, tank! Manhattan Project was another one from the Second World War, 1940s, where they didn't want anybody to know what they were actually working on, so they just gave it the name of name of an island, and said, this is the Manhattan Project. Oh, well, what's that? I'm sorry, you don't need to know. Oh, okay, well, that's fine. You can hear Manhattan Project and not go to jail. Oh, okay, yeah, that's pretty good. Another thing we do is we repurpose words. So have you ever wondered why it is you drive a car? You ride a bicycle, you ride a horse, you drive a car. That's because if you have a team of horses pulling a cart, you actually have you're driving the team, trying to get them to go where you want them to go. So it's kind of similar, sort of, that, you know, you're doing something that's like driving a horse team, except it's got a motor in on it. It's kind of the same. So we adopt the word that's most like what we're going to do, even though it doesn't really make a whole lot of sense. But it's sort of similar, kind of. Every now and then, we decide to get really clever. Okay, pull yourself up by your bootstraps. All right, that's an old idiom that used to mean, yeah, you're so low that when you look up, you see your boots. Okay, used to be, you had a computer. The first thing you did was you keyed in the bootstrap loader, which would then load the real loader, which would then load the operating system, which would then start your computer. So you had a bootstrap loader, well, but then nobody wants to say bootstrap, so you just say, I'm going to boot the computer. Nowadays, we boot computers. Most people don't know why it is you boot a computer. It's not a really rational thing to want to do to a computer. I mean, if you think in terms of a boot. Again, somebody got clever. Another thing we do is metaphor. Well, okay, we have and the desktop metaphor is the most famous one, of course, in the technology sector. This isn't a desktop, it's a screen, and especially when it was a CRT that was about, you know, yay deep and yay big, and had a screen about yay high with a little bit of text on it. The introduction of the desktop metaphor for using the computer was a major advance. So the things that you have on a desktop, of course, are named after the things that you would have on a real desktop. You have documents, you have files, you have paper clips. Anybody remember the paper clip? Yeah, okay. Yeah, that one died pretty fast. But metaphorically, it made sense to actually use that, and in fact, in the way it was actually used. So when we adopt the metaphor to explain things, we bring in other things that are related to that, and kind of make a complete story in the jargon that we're using when we're talking about what you see on your computer screen. And then, of course, there are inside jokes. Inside jokes are a lot of fun, except that they're not very inclusive, because they're inside jokes, obviously. So software. Well, the computer doesn't work right, but hardware checks out. I often wonder why it is we didn't decide to call it EasyWare. Hard, easy, hard, soft. Okay, well, yeah, it could have gone either way. They went with software, that's fine. So, yeah, we've continued the joke. We have firmware now, too, which is software that's in the hardware that you can't actually pull out, so it's firm. We're clever, okay? It's a joke. It's funny. Laugh. Thank you. Okay, bugs. Okay. Yeah, the old thing about the moth in the relay, haha. Okay, yeah, that way we don't have to call it a flaw. That's actually pretty good. I feel a whole lot better having bugs in my computer than having flaws. Jiffy. I like Jiffy, okay? It's like, well, we need a unit of time that isn't actually defined to be anything in particular. Jiffy, yeah, I'll be there in a jiffy. The failed Unibus address register, or FUBAR, on your VAX 11780, this was a great one because they actually got it into the manual and shipped before anybody noticed this. Yeah, they had somebody who from the legal department who reviewed the engineering documentation, but apparently they fell asleep before they got to that section, or they just were skimming over it and say, yeah, Unibus address, okay, yeah, whatever. Yeah. And didn't look to see what it actually came out is an acronym. So we have all these wonderful ways to create jargon. The group all agrees on how it should be used. Everybody's communicating clearly and efficiently. How could this possibly become gibberish? It's like, how could it lose its meaning? Well, there's some inherent problems with jargon, with using language in a particular way. Probably the most prevalent of one is ambiguity. Okay. Does the Mac implement Mac on the Mac? And should you wear a Mac while you're doing that? In general, when we use jargon, when we don't tend to abbreviate things the same way, within a group, or we try not to, but it slips in sometimes, and sometimes you can't really avoid it. Sometimes you've got subgroups where this group uses it this way and this group uses it this way, and they come together and they confuse each other. But that's just one of the inherent problems. Another of the inherent problems, and this is one that bites us more often than we would like to think, that is that acronyms are not words. Okay, acronyms are abbreviations, and this is a case where you get really, really hammered if you're in an international environment. I was in a series of meetings where we were talking about access control lists, and I was saying, yeah, the ACL does this and the ACL does that. And a native French speaker came up to me after the meeting and said, please don't do this. Say ACL. Because as a native French speaker, he's interpreting every word that's spoken into his native concepts, or sets of words into his native concepts, so that he can understand it. When he hears a word that isn't a word being used, he can't do one of his primary things. When you say ACL, he says, ah, that might be any number of things, but in the context, it's probably access control list. I know what that is conceptually in my native language, so I can actually think about it. As you're listening and translating what you're hearing, it slows you down. If you're going too fast, or you're using terms that don't make a lot of sense, or that aren't really words, you actually have to do another layer of translation, and it makes communication extremely difficult, even within a group where you've agreed on this is the way things are. So the fact that acronyms aren't words, that it makes it very difficult to communicate when you're not just doing it automatically. We have translation and interpretation not only on a language basis, but also on a cultural basis or an experiential basis. Cultural biases. I have mine. I freely confess, y'all have your own too. It's like, you can't deny it. We have two people here on the slide here, one of whom is was a rear admiral in the US Navy. Born in 1906, we have a kid over here born in 2006. They're both programmers. They should be able to speak clearly to each other, right? Well, they've got a whole bunch of biases, including the experiential. The kid has very little. The admiral has a whole lot. One grew up with American English. One is with Mandarin Chinese. Okay. Also raised in the 20th century, 21st century. One writes in COBOL. One writes in Node.js. Now, those two languages do have a lot of real important similarities, I think. But just the idea that we've got two people with that diverse experience, that diverse mindset, that diverse background, and cultural biases. If one is talking to the other, there's a whole lot of translation going on. This next bit is probably the most sensitive part of the talk, and if I do not intend to offend anybody, if I do, I apologize in advance here. Okay, what's said and what's heard? Does anybody here speak with an accent? Okay, good. If I say, no. In security, we have a thing called a stack canary. What is it? It's a little piece of data that you have on the stack in your software that you put a value into it, and at some point in the future, you're going to look and see if that value is the same as it was before, and if it's changed, well, you know something's gone amiss, and you've got a problem. But why do we call it a canary? Or some people will say canary, and some people will say connery. Again, my linguistic skills are limited. But those are two different ways you might hear this same word pronounced. Now, with my biases, when I hear canary, I think in terms of a place where they tin fish. And I go, what's he talking about? All right. Now, if somebody from Sydney says it and says canary, I go, oh. He's talking about a little yellow bird. Why have we got a little yellow bird sitting in my software stack? This doesn't make any sense at all. Unless you actually have the cultural background to know about miners in the 18th and 19th centuries who would take a caged canary down into the mine. And if the canary died, that meant that there was poisonous gas in the mine and it was time to leave. Without that story, the whole bit about a stack canary doesn't make any sense at all. Now, it certainly doesn't make sense if you think in terms of tinned fish. So those are inherent problems. So things that just will go wrong with jargon from the get-go. But you can also acquire problems. Okay? How could that be, I hear you say? Well, if there's a change in the activity, you can have a very significant change in the jargon. In California, a large set of the law now says that the use of cannabis is a legal activity. Didn't used to be. It used to be illegal. There's all sorts of jargon among the people who use it about that they would say to obfuscate the fact that that's what they were doing. Now we've got a whole slew of new jargon that's been introduced describing the effects on your joints and the pain and all kinds of other things about it. The jargon has just changed completely. Another time where you might change the activities, you might introduce a new technology. Has anybody adopted containers in the past 5 years? Okay, you got a whole bunch of new jargon to go along with that. Okay, because the activity that you've been working with has changed. You've done something different with the way you're going about your activity. Your group might change. This happens all the time, and it's especially dangerous when you have a relatively homogeneous group. So one thing I've seen happen at startup companies time and time again is you've got a bunch of engineers, they're doing a product, they're making their thing work well. They've got their jargon, they're talking to each other, they're communicating clearly, and they're getting close to release, and so they hire a marketing person. Now all of a sudden, your group has changed significantly, and the words you use don't make any sense to all the group anymore. The jargon doesn't work for the marketing person. The marketing person comes and he tries to understand what it is you're telling them, and they're just kind of going, okay, you left me at the bakery. That's role-based, but cultures. Haven't anybody ever actually worked in an outsourcing project where you decide, oh, well, we're going to take this part of the work that we're doing, and we're going to have the people in Alabama take care of this. Well, you're going to have some cultural shifts then. You're going to say some things and they're not going to understand. They have different culture. You may hire somebody new. Somebody new, fresh out of college, comes into the group. They don't have the background. Or you may hire somebody who's a venerable sage in the field to come in and help you finish off your project. And now they've got a different set of background as well. Because the group has changed, the jargon may not make sense anymore. And when people are, somebody will come in and say, yes, your VTAM LRECL needs to be reformatted. And everybody goes, whoa, what's that? You don't know. When you change the group, you change the jargon. Sometimes our jargons clash. I work on security in an open source kernel. Great. Security jargon and kernel jargon do not match. Open source jargon and security jargon don't match. There is some overlap. There's a little bit, little triangular bit in the middle there, where you can communicate with kernel people and security people and open source people. We all know what that means. But there's a lot of stuff that goes on in the kernel that generally open source people wouldn't understand, generally security people wouldn't understand. It's all a mishmash here of clashing jargons. One of my favorite examples of this is when we mix jargon from Linux and Windows. Has anybody ever heard somebody say, yeah, well, how many files do you have in that folder? Linux doesn't have folders. Linux has directories. Windows people get really upset when you refer to a dynamically loadable segment of code as a library. It's not a library, it's a DLL. They're similar. It's like it's the best match you can make of this jargon to that jargon. But if you're not using the jargon in the context of where it really should be, people will usually get it, but sometimes not. Okay. Furthermore, sometimes there's a real significant difference between the two things that are similar that you're mixing the jargon of. Directories and folders have different semantics. They don't work the same way. They don't contain the same stuff. But conceptually, they're about as close as you're going to be able to get and still be able to look at them. So you can mix the jargon. It will work sometimes, but not all the times. And sometimes people will say things, well, we all know that a directory contains the all kinds of metadata about the file that's in the directory. It's like, well, no, it doesn't. Windows folders do that. Linux directories don't. So you've mixed the jargon, and you've gotten things confused, and you're not doing anybody any good. OK, so the next thing that happens is buzzwording. Has anybody ever had a perfectly good piece of jargon get destroyed when the marketing guy says, hey, we're going to put that in the brochure? Well, that's not really what it means. Yeah, but it sounds great in the context. We're going to sell a million of these things. All we have to do is call it this. Hacker is my personal... favorite is kind of a hard word, harsh word to use on it. Used to be back in the old days, back in the way old days, a hack was what you did when you had limited resources and you didn't really have enough resources to make the computer do the thing you wanted it to, but you were able to sneak something in somehow, use an illegal instruction, who knows what, to make something work, and that was a hack. And if you could do that regularly, you were a hacker, and that put you at the cream of the crop, you were the best. And the press decided that people who did that kind of thing were doing it for nefarious purposes. And so a hacker became somebody who did that for evil purposes rather than good purposes. And so today, a hacker is a bad person. You know, they're bad people. Ooh, bad hackers. It got turned into a buzzword. It doesn't mean what it used to mean. As the audience for the term got bigger, it expanded and lost its meaning, lost the context of the meaning, lost the important part of the meaning, which was that this was a really good thing you could do. Anybody ever play Buzzword Bingo? Yeah, it's grand fun. You're in a big corporate big corporate environment. CEO is up talking about paradigm shifts and how they're going to use big data analytics to be disruptive in the marketplace, and somebody shuts up, bingo. Yeah, CEOs never figured that one out. It's still funny. Okay, so geezers talk funny. We do. It's like we use jargon back from the 1970s. We think long is 32 bits. I grew up being taught that you could identify the difference between a mini computer, a microcomputer, a mini computer, and a mainframe by the number of bits in an integer. It was 8, 16, and 32. So I don't know what we have now. We have like PCs, I guess. These 64-bit things. That's just too much data for us geezers to understand. And if you've ever actually had a floppy disk that was floppy, you're a geezer. But that's okay. It's okay that we talk funny, because kids talk funny too. Big long mail thread, seven levels of indentation in it, commentary all over the place, and at the very top it says plus one. Oh, okay. That means I agree, I guess. All right. Containers. Again, this is buzzwords that were introduced very recently. We used to call these, what are currently called containers. Well, first off, does anybody know what a container is? okay, yeah. The reality is nobody knows what a container is because they are intentionally not committing any particular definition of a container because it's a marketing term. Everybody wants to market their thing as a container, regardless of what technology is behind it. It's really kind of fun. Now we're going to get into the serious part. One of the problems with jargon is that, and as groups change, as activities change, you tend to bring new people in, and sometimes they get offended. Okay, this is normal. This is normal. This is a normal consequence of using language in a specific way. Because if you use things in a specific way, okay, thank you. If you use things in a specific way, and somebody doesn't want that language to be used in that specific way, they can get offended. Now, just to be fair, being offended, when you're offended, you stop hearing things. Now, when you're delighted, you stop hearing things too. So you have to be careful with your jargon not to delight people too much. But if you're delighting people, nobody's really going to complain about it. But if you're offending people, yeah, you're probably going to get some feedback to that effect. Okay. But the important thing from the standpoint of jargon is that offended people don't listen. How do you offend people? Well, one way you offend people is with excessive familiarity. Familiarity doesn't scale. Anybody who has siblings knows that there are things you can say to your siblings that you couldn't say to anybody else, that they will accept and they will hear you, they will listen to you. Now, they'll punch you in the arm afterwards. But, the people right next to you, the people you know best, you can talk to, you can say things about. They'll smile, understanding what you really mean, the concepts you're really trying to get across. The people just outside of that who hear it are going to go, huh, that's kind of a strange way for them to be talking here. I hope that they know what they're doing. And then the people in the next ring are going, gosh, can you believe the way these people talk to each other? They are disrespectful. Okay, familiarity doesn't scale. And I had fun making this slide too. But I've always said that, you know, hey, we've always talked this way. Why should we change now just because there's more people coming in? You have to, okay? Things change, people change, groups change, activities change, change changes, all right? Sometimes the thing you used to do becomes inappropriate. Master-slave protocols. Blacklists and whitelists. I worked at a company. We were doing a secure version of the Unix operating system. We called it Project Harem. Why? Well, because that's where you keep the trusted Unix. Okay, that's offensive in so many ways. Okay, everybody in the room should take offense at that in some way. Okay, it was a homogeneous group of white men. Straight white men working in a laboratory. It didn't occur to us that that might actually be offensive to somebody. Yeah, it was. Okay. And the famous one from the Linux community, you're an idiot. Again, I could tell my brother that. I could tell some members of the audience that. And they would just be, yeah, I kind of agree with you because of what I just, you know, things that just happened here. But that doesn't scale. You can't say that to just anybody. Okay? We have a code of conduct. There's a reason for that. Okay? Because in any activity, you have the opportunity to offend people. And from the viewpoint of the activity moving forward, you are inhibiting the activity by offending people. All right, jargon can be bad about that. Yeah. So you have to start swimming or you'll sink like a stone. Yeah, things change. We just have to go with that. So, jargon, it's actually a pretty good thing. It's actually a very useful tool. There are things we can do to be aware of, be cognizant of when you're using jargon to actually keep it going. The first one, is there anybody, okay. I am willing to assume that everybody in this audience is clever. Okay? You wouldn't have come to hear me talk if you weren't. The people at this conference are generally intellectually elite. We know you're clever. You're working in this activity, you're working with this group, okay? You don't have anything to prove. You don't have to jump off a building backwards with a parachute to prove that to us, okay? We accept you. Yeah, you're part of the group. You don't have to use language in a way that proves something. When you're talking to a group, you need to know your audience. I have a pretty good idea in general about the aspects of the people that are in the audience today. I don't have spotlights on each of you, and I don't have a dossier. But the activity you're embarking on, the people who are participating in that activity have mindsets, they have biases. When you know those biases to some extent, and you use the jargon that will actually work in that context. So whether you're talking at a Linux conference or whether you're going to a Clue party, you can speak better with the people in the group if you know what the group's all about. Take your time. When people's eyes start to glaze over, communication stops. All right. I've been in meetings where people put up slides and there isn't a single actual English word anywhere on the slide. It's all acronyms and abbreviations and even the verbs. At which point you go, okay, yeah, I'm checking out. You're not going to communicate under those circumstances. So jargon's about understanding. It really is. It's about speeding up understanding. Okay. So you feed language, background, culture, roles into that to make understanding. And that's why we have jargon. And that's how it can become gibberish. And that's why helicopters eat their young. And special bonus points to anybody who can identify this location.
New Zealand, isn't it?
No. But it was a good guess.
Perth.
Perth? No, it's not Perth.
Earth.
Cute. You're being clever. Okay? He's using jargon. Okay? Very, very good. Okay. So thank you very much. Do we have time for questions? Time for two questions. Okay.
First question is, where was the photo taken?
Wales.
Second question, why do you have to look?
Sorry?
Why do you have to look at the screen?
Why do you have to look?
Oh, that was for dramatic effect. You see, if you just stand here like this and give your talk, nobody pays any attention because they're getting really bored. But if you do things like this, then people say, oh, look, he's engaged. Maybe he didn't get that himself. Well, so, yeah. Okay, so next question. Or do those count? Okay, those count. Thank you very much. You've been a lovely audience.
Thank you.